Okay. This changes the slide. Improvement. Try. It works. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. I apologize in advance because, as usual, I put together all the slides with not much time in advance, so we didn't have time to exchange with Riccardo, with John. So we might have, I hope, not too many inconsistencies, but. Let's go on. I will describe quickly the physics program of the FCC-HH, and here I've listed the questions or the ingredients of the physics program. Could we understand the dynamics of the electroweak symmetry breaking? How far we can go with using precision measurements of the standard model particles in looking for new physics? Could we interpret the baryogenesis as some product of the cosmological electroweak phase transition? A very important question. Could we search for physics beyond the standard model, looking directly to new massive particles or new interactions? Could we find a solution, a natural solution for the Little hierarchy problem? And is the Tev scale dynamics, a la WIMPs, at the origin of dark matter? Trying to answer to this question, I make some assumption. First of all, since dreaming is not very expensive, so I've dreamt of having FCC-HH that starts 5 years after FCC-EE. FCC-EE has not completed its program, but it has already accumulated a huge amount of precision measurements on the Higgs couplings, on the top, on the W mass. And another part of the dream, FCC-EE and FCC-HH run in parallel. Maybe it's not possible, but I tell you, we can dream of it. Eh? Imagine what we could do today if you would have had still the possibility of having a plus and minus machine running in parallel, maybe we have to be upgraded. I don't know. It's an ideal scenario. And then another part of the dream that, by the way, is becoming now maybe conservative is that I assume an accumulated integrated statistics of about 3 to 10 inverse Atobarn. So I might have been conservative here because I'm very happy to hear that we might exceed these numbers by some factor. I will not mention in the Stoke heavy ion or fixed target experiment, many, many other ideas that are flying around, including physics with injectors. So the physics measurement that would be a possible at FCC-HH, the list is not exhaustive with the presentation that I will present you today. The basic question that we are facing today, this is the origin of the confusion that correctly Riccardo pointed out in his talk, is that basically with the inclusion of this object of 125 GeV, for the first time in history, we have a description of nature that could be consistent up to very high energy. Now we know that this could be. Be a possibility. A light boson, in principle, could rule itself interaction and the Yukawa interaction with fermions in such a way that the theory could remain weakly coupled up to the Planck scale without any new dynamics appearing beyond the Fermi scale, the electroweak scale. And clearly, if this would be the case, and we could be able to prove it, this would be an outstanding result in itself. We could have, for the first time, a theory that described nature over 15 order of magnitudes. Clearly, if this would be the case, we have to change the name. We cannot call it the standard model. We call it the theory, I mean, something which is really describing nature in full glory. But I think it's too early, tough to. Although this is a possibility, and we should be aware of this possibility, it's probably too early to consider this will be the case. And there are many reasons for this, but a thing that I consider very, very instructive for me is that the Higgs boson is a source of a new set of questions. And for me, this is the real interesting part of the game. I took it from Michelangelo's presentation at the kickoff meeting. But again, if you go through this list, what's the real origin of the Higgs potential? There is an underlying strong dynamics, it's composite X. There is the RG evolution from the Planck scale. There are partners of the X. Again, the Little hierarchy program. the great hierarchy problem. There is a relation between Higgs, electroweak symmetry breaking, and dark matter. And again, what is the order of the phase transition of the electroweak phase transition during the Big Bang? Because depending on the order, we might realize that there is a role of this transition in producing the asymmetry between matter and antimatter. So we are really facing fundamental questions. And again, there is any relation between biogenesis and dark matter. So can we live without new physics? We know that there are many phenomena, natural phenomena, that are not described by the standard model. Although the couplings can fly up to the Planck scale quite nicely, but to answer this question, I think we have to really consider, let's say, the high energy physics as a part of an effort, and that Riccardo described quite well. This effort would include the precision measurements, neutrino physics, cosmological measurements, and then putting together also what we could do using accelerator, then we might be able to give an answer to this question. So why 100 TeV? 100 TeV is not only because it's probably the highest possible, technically possible energy we can face today, but is an energy regime which will allow us to fully understand the dynamics of the electroweak symmetry breaking. For the first time, we'll be able to explore the electroweak theory in a regime which is in which electroweak interactions are not broken, with the square root of S much larger than the vacuum expectation value. So again, we have the possibility to test directly this, and this will be, we can translate it in probing the utilization of the WW longitudinal scattering for an invariant mass of the system, for a mass of the system much larger than the TeV. And we can explore the dynamics well above the electroweak symmetry breaking, because we might have the tool to identify any possible particle that could have some weak interaction in this regime. So I quoted here, fatti non foste a vivere come brutti, ma per seguire virtute conoscenza. Is this effort that brings us in this regime. And this regime, this energy regime, is particularly interesting because it could be possible for us to explore this phase transition in full detail. And if you have a 100 TeV machine, what is the bread and butter physics you can do? For example, take a look to this cross section. You have QCD jets up to 25, 30 TeV. You can really explore the running of alpha strong easily, let's say, quotation mark. You can explore quark compositeness up to 140 TeV. And this will be the first weeks of operation of this machine, if this machine will be sometime in the future really built. We can have off-shell, take a look to the W and Z. You can have off-shell W and Z production above 10 TeV, Drellian mass, which allows you to measure the running of the electroweak couplings. Again, if there is something happening that has something to do with the electroweak interaction, it will appear as an anomaly in these processes. This will be an important process that will be studied, by the way, at high luminosity LHC. We know very well that in the standard model, the Z and the H exchange diagrams diverge and cancel exactly each other. This is the mechanism that we have to investigate. The mechanism can be investigated parametrizing, as usual, any anomaly as factors A and B. In a high luminosity LHC, we can have a precision on A and B at the level of 30%. FCCE will give us a huge precision on A. With FCCHH, we might have 1% precision again on A and B. So it's something that we should do, because through this measurement, we can close an issue in a way or in another. Or we really simply fit the expectation, or we say we find something new. And this is also another important area, because again, take a look to the huge cross-section of multi-boson production, 2W, 3W, WWZ, 4W, etc. So we could have an extensive problem of the electroweak interaction in the energy regime, again, with the same spirit. Stressing this theory in an energy regime which is far away from the one that we have already explored, the Fermi scale. This is another part of the game that could be particularly interesting. I took it from Christophe's slide. We could perform precision studies of the electroweak phase transition. Again, the exact dynamics of the electroweak phase transition could have some connection with cosmology. So depending on the order at which this transition happens, we might have a scenario that could be possible. Could be, you should hint, you should assume that there are beyond standard model particles. In this case, you can have deviations in the x-coupling. I mean, to study this means study the x-couplings with high precision. It's the same old story. But the possibility to say yes or no to different scenarios which have cosmological impacts, in my view, is an important question to be addressed properly. We know very well that order 1% precision in measuring the X, or better, X couplings could be as important as direct searches for new physics. In this respect, we could look for the study of the triple X coupling, even quadruple X coupling, if possible. This is why statistics could help. Higher luminosity in this sense will be important. Frank took not a very convincing plot once you showed that you increase the mass reach for heavy object. This is not the reason why we want higher luminosity, because usually the gain is not huge. You gain a few TeV, while it's much more important if you have to study rare decays or very rare processes, that then you need really statistics, you need luminosity. And you could even search for new sources of CP evaluation, again, addressing the issue, one of the most fundamental issues in nature, why we live in a matter world and there is this asymmetry that is puzzling us since decades. Again, now we take a look to what happens to Higgs and top cross-section at 100 TeV. Take a look. I like to compare the cross-section, for example, of the TT bar at 100 TeV with the cross-section at 8 TeV of the W and Z. Just for people working at LHC experiment, this is an immediate feeling. You see huge statistics of the TT bar to be compared with the statistics we have today of the W and Z. And do the same exercise for the Higgs, again. The Higgs will come with a cross-section which is comparable to the TT bar. LHC is a top factor, you know, so we have plenty of this, and we clearly believe we have the will be an X factory, and also the elusive processes that we want to study, the triple X coupling, could be compared to the VBF processes that we have been able to publish and to study. So again, this gives us the feeling that this machine, you know, will allow us to take all, even the most difficult and the most challenging processes, with something that could be compared, at least in terms of, there is no selection, no acceptance, nothing here, but gives you the feeling where we could be in trying, in aiming to study these processes. If you translate the 10 inverse Hatto-Barn 10 TeV, then the numbers that you get is 10 to the 10 Higgs boson, which is a factor 10,000 today statistics. Clearly, you can address not only precision measurements, but also rare decays, flavor change in neutral currents, new decay modes. You can have, again, 10 to the 12 top quarks, 5, 10 to the 4 today statistics. Again, precision measurements, rare decays, and CP violation eventually. In addition, you have clean, high-intensity particle, I call particle beams from the top decays, because you have 10 to the 12 W boson, 10 to the 12 B jets, you have W in tau, so you can have, again, a lot of W in charged hadrons, so you have test beams. You can have, if you think to your detector properly, you can use this to produce an incredible amount of precision measurements on this. And here there is room for new ideas, and detector optimized not only to measure the major processes, but able to have a physics problem which is large and covering also some of this part. For example, rare decays of the tau and of the charm would be accessible with the statistics. If we concentrate on the X physics properly, in particular the processes that will be difficult at LHC high luminosity, which are the two TTH and TRIPO and HH, the two processes which will be complex, will be addressed, but clearly we are already aware that even at LHC high luminosity will not be able to perform incredibly precise measurements of these processes. Here you see in this table the ratio between the cross-section at with respect to the cross-section at 14 TeV, which is here, the cross-section at 100 TeV. You see that you gain a factor 60-40. And since, again, the community of LHC knows that we'll be able to do something already significant in these two areas, at least to try to do it, we are quite confident that this machine will be able to bring us in this area. So these two will be the key players in the new machine. Clearly, consider also that for all this process, if you request high invariant mass in the final state, you gain factors. So the factors that you see here, 14, 20, call it 20, apart the two last processes, can become 200 if you ask for high mass or high PT, which is another part of the study. In some sense, there is a natural complementarity between FCCE and FCCHH. It's clear that coupling like XWW and ZZ, coupling to the vector bosons, are already strongly constrained by the electroweak phase transition. And if there are deviations from the standard model, the deviation is very small. And the right machine to address this precision measurement of this coupling is in the FCCE. There is no question about it. You see that the goal, the reasonable goal, are sub percent, even sub per mil precision that can be achieved in this coupling. So there is no gain. This is why I was dreaming of having FCCEE running first, because this will constrain a lot the entire picture. On the other hand, coupling involved in rare decays, H2 mu mu or H2 Z gamma, and HHH will be much less constrained, even by FCCEE. So this, the FCCHH is the big player for lambda, lambda tau, lambda top, K mu, and K Z gamma. Here you see what this machine could do for the two major channels in which FCCHH could play a role, TTH and the triple Higgs coupling. And you see that we are talking of 1% for lambda top and 8% for lambda, which is probably an underestimation, because clearly, for example, for the lambda, we are considering today in this study only the BB gamma gamma final state, and we know already from LHC high luminosity that we could do better. We could put together other decay modes. X rare decay, this is the status of CMS, H2 mu mu, H2 Z gamma. We expect Z gamma to be K Z gamma measured at the level of 40%, 10% with 300 inverse femtobar. It will be difficult to go much below for FCCEE in this particular channel. The same is true for K mu, is the direct coupling to fermions of the second generation. And again, studies here are very, very preliminary, but I think we could target the 1% precision for these couplings. Again, this is another area in which statistics will help. Top physics with 10 inverse attobarn, again, 10 to the 12 tops. You can select systems with very high invariant mass. You have such an abundance of top that you can really cut on the PT or the invariant mass of the TT bar system, that you can gain the factor 200 or the 250 that we were talking before. And here you have large indirect sensitivity to new physics through virtual effect producing anomalies in well-predicted variables. An example here is the application of top dipole moments. Clearly, you will enter the multi-top world. You produce multi-top production, TT with a couple of W, gamma, Z, gamma, WZ, ZZ, again, looking for any possible anomaly with respect to prediction. You can access the top PDF. And clearly, if you have a machine of 100 TV, you look for direct search. So at a certain moment, you have precision measurement, but you have also direct search for new particles. The typical regime allows you, the typical mass you can reach is about 30 TeV. But this is important and clearly will be addressed quickly, but it's also important, for me it's important to stress that you have high statistics for the tele-exploration of the TV regime. So the Fermi regime should be explored with high statistics. In addition, you will explore the energy regime. In addition, you can access very rare processes, including, Riccardo mentioned it, the holes that might be left over from LHC may be, again, revised through FCC-HH, because we might be able to come back and try to complete the searches in the low-energy regime. If you compare LHC, we are using this in these days, comparing the reach in mass of LHC-8 versus LHC-14, and you see there is again one or two in mass. If you use the same plot for LHC-14 versus FCC-100, you see the gain is about 5 or 6. So as a rule of thumb, you can use factor 5 or 6 in the mass reach if you want to understand your preferred analysis, how can be done, what will be the result at FCC, FCC-HH. And I come to the to something again which is very much followed by with attention by Riccardo, the search for the third generation squarks. This is an ATLAS result. Again, caveat the holes that that were described before. The current limits with the C running at 13-14 TeV gain a factor 2, so arrive if you call it 600, they arrive about 1,200 or maybe 1,000, and then 20% if you reach the 3,000 inverse. But the message here is very clear. If there is no hint at 300 inverse femtobarn, there will be no much fun at 3,000 inverse femtobarn. So this we should be aware. Because if there will be a 5 sigma discovery with 3,000 inverse femtobarn, you should have something already in the first 300 inverse femtobarn. So we'll know soon what is the case. While clearly a machine at 100 TeV will not be able not only to cover this region is out of the scale, but also to cover the scenario that, again, Riccardo was describing before, with the pattern of the top that can be as high as 9, 8, or 9. It looks like we were synchronized in this, but I didn't. So it appears to be, we can exclude the 9 TeV stops in this region again. And clearly will be a challenge for SUSY model builders. This is the famous Mahmoudi plot, the exclusion plots for LHC at 14 TeV, including the dark matter constraints, and this is 100 TeV. Okay, I'm pretty sure there will be other models that will survive, but at least we could close an entire series of models that are still alive. Then we can search for heavy resonances. Again, now we apply the rule of thumb. You see that what the limits today for the Z prime are around 3 TeV would become 7 TeV at LHC high luminosity to reach 35 TeV with the factor 5 that I was describing you before, so makes sense. And for other exotic states, take a look to your favorite model in Exotica and you will understand from this plot what will be the reach for this machine. Lastly, we might have the possibility, even for WIMP candidates like WINO or IXINO, whose limits seems to be in the TeV region, 1 to 3 TeV, again, to be able to cover the entire allowed phase space, although you should be aware that was already mentioned, dark matter could well be axions or strange beasts that don't like to deliver signals in our accelerator-driven researches. So, conclusions. I think the physics problem is absolutely magnificent, and there is plenty. The thing that I like is plenty of room for new ideas. So, just at the beginning of this, exploration. And I'm pretty sure that the exploration of this new energy regime will change in depth our current vision of matter and the universe. We don't know in which directions. This is the funny part of our work. We don't know exactly what will be the vision of nature that will come after this exploration. But I'm sure that what are the next steps? First of all, we have to study the properties of the main physics objects, which have peculiar properties in this energy regime, jets, high PT object, B, tau, tau, peaks, tagging, VBF topology. Everything should be re-discussed, re-studied, not from scratch, because we have already experienced, but we have to be prepared to a completely different set of topologies in the new kinematic regime. We have to study the implication at detector at trigger level, clearly. But the third point is also very important. We have to improve the theoretical understanding of the new territory, and we have to work in strict contact with our friend theorists, not only to perform additional studies, but also to improve the precision in many of these studies that I mentioned before. That's it. Marcus?
You made a point almost as a side remark. He said that if you don't have a 3 sigma effect at 300 inverse femtobarn, it's going to be boring. I think it's going to be a very exciting discussion, because if you don't have 3 sigma effect in 300 inverse femtobarn, we have done something wrong analyzing our data. So you ought to have a statistical fluctuation, which says that you don't know if it's a first hint or a fluctuation. But even if you excluded something with 300 inverse femtobarn, that could be a downward fluctuation of a possible signal. So with a factor of two more data, you might have a 3 sigma excess and then a discovery later on. So we have to be a little bit careful with this kind of statement. I hear those statements actually quite a lot.
I tend to agree with you. I did it to provoke some discussion, because I think we should ask ourselves this question. No? Although myself will be motivated to continue, even if there is no hint. But I didn't mention 3 sigma, I mentioned some hints, but you are completely right.
Other questions?
Mentioned an exposure of 10 attobarns. How many Ws would you get in that exposure? You said from 10 to 12 from tops, but how many?
You can have tagged the W, but you can have
10 to 14 Ws.
Yeah. You can extrapolate from the cross section, order 10 to the 14, if I remember correctly. Yeah. Is 100 goes here, so is it 1,000 nanobars, so it's a W factory.
Yeah.
It's a problem of a trigger, clearly, because again, the problem is it's not clear if we could maintain the trigger threshold on the electrons. It's not easy. This is if you want to use it as a W factory, it's tough technically.
The other day, I was told that there would be no threshold, no trigger. Everything would be recorded.
Manuel, maybe you can comment. You want to comment it? We have very good experts in the room.
Depends on the event size.
Yeah, coming back to these Ws, I think the absolute number is impressive, but the interesting Ws are all the ones we haven't seen yet, right? The TeV to 10 TeV I don't know how many TeV. And it will be very exciting to see what we're going to do about hadronic decays of 10 TeVWs. I don't think we have a clear idea of how we distinguish those from jets. They might actually be narrower.
Very narrow. They would be very
QCD jets, so that might be a handle. But I think there's a lot of exciting studies to be done there. I'm not sure how far you are towards simulation.
Just at the beginning. Absolutely at the beginning of this. When I mentioned we have to study topology of a normal object, including normal electroweak object, is exactly this.
So basic.
Marcus can add.
Some answers like a full simulation of a sample of 10 TeVWs that could be available in a year. Is that optimistic?
I'm a bit optimistic on the availability of samples, because I was told it's a matter of months, it's not a matter of years.
With the detector.
Not full simulation, with the clearly simplified simulation is not something that will happen in a year from now. If I take the optimistic statement, it should come within this year, a reasonable amount of samples.
Yes, I guess that, in fact, we're going to have new samples. What we are learning now is where all the algorithms we know are failing, basically. So this is the first phase with the samples that we have available. We are learning the limits. And now with this new development that are coming up with all the framework, we should have new samples and at least new algorithm that start being tuned, because the reconstruction is completely different thing.
I don't see other hands, so let's thank you again.